Front row, it tastes like mint. It's because I just spit my Altoids in there. Thanks, Oz, for giving me Altoids. I told him I'm nervous. I'll breathe in heavy and suck them down in the middle of my conversation. That's no good. Hey, listen, put your hands together for Marjorie Roberts this morning. Say thank you up there. Yay! Yay! She's going to help us this morning. We are taking the opportunity to put everything that we're going to talk about on slides. If you want these, we can make these available to you. Some of you are writing notes and said to me, you know, I can't keep up, and that's fine. We'll go ahead and have a chance to put them on slides. And so this morning, let's take a minute if we could. Stand up with me. Stand up with me. You've been sitting for a little while already. Some of you haven't even left your seat since the first service. Stand up. All right. And take a breath, if you will. Let's pause and ask the Spirit of God to come and be the one who's our teacher today. So bow with me, please. Lord, we recognize that if there's anything of eternal value that's going to happen during this next hour, it's not going to be because of us, but it's going to be because of you. So as we think together and as we have a chance to share our thoughts with one another, we pray that you'll come as we investigate Scripture, help us to see with new eyes. And as we have a chance to think together and talk and have a conversation about the resurrection, help us to hear with new ears and be the one who's our teacher this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So before you sit down, find somebody whose name you don't know. You don't know their name, and introduce yourself this morning, if you would, please. I got that. So let's hit the ground running, and let's recap last Sunday and not spend a lot of time doing it. So let's go to the first slide, Marge. Here we go. There it is. We passed out this handout last Sunday before we started teaching, before we said anything, and we asked this question. We want to go ahead and find out the question about what sort of certainty that you had about the resurrection of Jesus. What sort of certainty you had about the resurrection of Jesus? And then we began to talk a little bit about some of the resources we were going to use during our time together over the next several weeks. And so I wanted to introduce you to a couple of authors and some names that you may or may not be familiar with, some that you probably should read or think about, especially if their name is attached to an article online, and then some that you're going to go ahead and think, huh, if I read them, they're going to give me certainly a different perspective. These are just the covers of the books we're using. There are a couple of more that aren't on there, but they fit pretty well right there. So notice, let's go to the next slide if we could. These people on the left-hand side are people that you want to read as authorities from the resurrection of Jesus Christ. They're people who've given their life to the study of the resurrection. Three out of those guys have PhDs and have studied more than 40 years about the resurrection of Christ and have authored a number of books. And so Craig Habermas and Licona, those guys all have doctorates. N.T. Wright is a notable authority and has written more books than I could ever read. Josh McDowell, if you're an old head like me, you'll recognize his name. His son also has picked up the whole business of apologetics. They've authored a couple books together. Lee Strobel, he's the case for faith guy, the case for Easter, the case for everything at that point, and that's Lee Strobel. So they're the people you should know. On the right-hand side, these people are the skeptics that you're going to hear from mostly, and they're the loudest people, the loudest voice on the internet, and also in print. John Dominic Crossan, he is a guy who is involved in that third thing, the Jesus Seminar. He is a skeptic at that point. And Bart Ehrman, this guy is a prolific author, and he teaches down at North Carolina Chapel Hill, and he has a background of conservative evangelical worldview, world thought. But listen, William Lane Craig, they went to the same college together, and William Lane Craig maintains biblical authority, and Bart Ehrman went over here somewhere, but he's brilliant, and he has some interesting ideas when it comes to why you should kind of look at skeptical eyes with Scripture. And so if you'd like to go ahead and read on that side of the aisle, if you want to go ahead and use that terminology, you're welcome to. Those are the names that we're using during the next few weeks. Let's go to the next slide if we could. And we said that this really becomes the foundation for why we're going to talk a little bit about the resurrection. And I have to tell you that I've not been in many locations where we've elevated this thought off of the page. The first part of this verse, we go ahead and do very well inside of our culture, especially in 2024. You're going to hear about how important it is to receive Jesus Christ and confess with your mouth that He is Lord. We do that really well. And so we even say when we come to faith in Jesus Christ, all you have to do is to put your trust in Jesus and believe in Him and put your trust in Jesus and cross the line of faith. But for the second part of this verse, probably because we live in a culture that is very suspicious of supernatural work to begin with, the idea that it's important to understand, and notice how this is worded, it's not that Jesus walked out of the tomb, it's that God raised Him from the dead. This is critically important, because if God were not in place at that point, if this were just dependent upon Jesus, the whole picture looks different. Because God is still on the throne, God is still in place, God the Father, because God has done this in the life of Jesus, it's remarkable then what He can do in your life then and what He can do in my life. Do not miss the second part of this verse. It is critically important. And for me, having the opportunity to go ahead and focus a little bit more attention on that becomes a bit more significant, even in our conversation. It helps us a little bit. And so then we ask this question. As you were filling out that card, the very first slide, what is it then that compels you to believe in the resurrection? What is it that compels you to believe in the resurrection? And so we said we're going to think a little bit about three particular ways to approach the resurrection. And so the one is the internal witness of the Spirit. The internal witness of the Spirit. And that is the fact that God's witness, God's Holy Spirit bears witness with your Holy Spirit, and you just know that you know that you know. And it's interesting, then, some of us, we're going to go ahead and say, when we read the Bible, we just know. I've been raised in a situation where I just know. I know this is true, and so we have the internal witness of the Holy Spirit. And so John Wesley often would use this terminology, interchangeable, and he would say, it's the assurance of the Holy Spirit. We just know that these things are true inside of our life. Then we said the philosophical approach, you know, are miracles really possible? And in fact, this is where that language in Romans 10 becomes so important. God raised Jesus from the dead. Has everything to do with worldview. If God did not do that, or if God were not part of your worldview, these areas of philosophical or supernatural just would not take place. And we said we're not going to spend a ton of time here in the next couple of weeks. We are going to spend a lot of time on bullet point number 3, the historical idea, the factual events relating to the bodily resurrection of Jesus. Now, very quickly then, because we're going to deal and lean more into the historical dynamic, we said that it's important to recognize that there are things that happen in history, and how do we validate things that happen in history? Let's go to the next slide if we could. We said there's a couple of really quick observations. We said that multiple independent sources support historical claims. Multiple independent sources support historical claims. That means that this, Frank, stand up for me if you will. Carl, stand up with me, if you will. Cody, stand up with me, if you will, okay? Now, no, 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 I didn't say come here. I just said stand up, okay? Just stand up. Now, listen, if all of these guys were on site, or all these guys were on site, and they had an opportunity to go ahead and witness something, they would all, you would think, have independent resources. They'd have independent knowledge of what happened. However, let's say that Cody was on site, and he was in a small group with Carl and with Frank. And Cody said to Carl, hey, listen, let me tell you what happened. And Cody said to Frank, hey, let me tell you what happened. You don't have three independent sources. You have one. You have one. Are you with me? This is kind of important. You guys can sit down. Thanks. You're champs. Nice job. Okay, so listen. Independent, multiple independent sources, not dependent on somebody else's story, multiple independent sources. Then two, affirmation by a neutral or hostile source, okay? People who are not related to the story, people not friends of the story, people who are kind of disassociated from the story. That is a strong validation historically. Then three, embarrassing admissions support historical eyewitnesses. Here's an embarrassing part of the resurrection. The disciples were all hiding because they didn't want to be found out and get caught. That's embarrassing. Why would you tell the story that you're hiding because you didn't want to go ahead and be found out? That's an embarrassing fact, right? It's an embarrassing fact. Last week we said, too, another embarrassing fact, that the women were the hero of the story. Women are the hero of the story, and we'll have a bit more time to spend on that. Eyewitness testimony is considered stronger, okay? So let's go back to Cody, Carl, and Frank, okay? So Cody's witness would be much better because he is an eyewitness account than it would be if Carl and Frank got the story secondhand. And so that's really kind of important. We'll talk a little bit about that today a bit more. And then early testimony. The closer you are to the event, the closer you are to the historical record, the closer you are, and when it gets written down, the more, or the stronger the argument is. Stronger the argument. Okay? You see all those five? Say amen. Okay, terrific. Now, here we go. We mentioned that the earliest creedal statement that we have that is close in proximity to the death and resurrection of Jesus, some would put it within 3 years. One person puts it as early as 2 years on that list that I gave you. One puts it as late as just 5 years. But within a five-year window, here is the creedal statement. It comes out of 1 Corinthians chapter 15. For we received, and I passed on to you as first importance, here they are, four things. Christ died for our sins. He was buried. He was raised on the third day, and that he appeared. Okay? This is right up against the resurrection of Jesus, and very, very early as far as the literature in the New Testament is concerned. Paul wrote these words, but they are not Paul's words. Paul reached back and grabbed the words, maybe of Peter himself, maybe of James, the brother of Jesus, not quite sure exactly, but this was already in place when Paul writes 1 Corinthians. And so this is not even a debatable issue inside of the early church or inside of biblical understanding or scholarship. Okay, so that's kind of important. So let's go to the next slide if we could. We mentioned there's a difference between resuscitation and resurrection. We said that resuscitation happens. People who had died in the Bible, they came back to life, they died again. They came back to life, they died again. Resurrection, they came back to life, they did not die again. So we closed last week with this understanding that Jesus died on the cross. Let's go to the next slide if we could. He died by crucifixion. We spent a few minutes talking about the issues around the death of Jesus, things that would validate his death, things that would go ahead and leave this not debatable, that Jesus died. I have to tell you, this becomes a critically important point for your faith and for mine. He died on the cross. Now, here's the interesting factoid. At least I find it interesting. Up until this point in the story of the resurrection or the crucifixion of Jesus, language changes around the idea of describing crucifixion. The word excruciating doesn't exist in vocabulary prior to crucifixion. The word excruciating is introduced. The etymology of the word excruciating can be traced back to the description of what it means for a person to have pain or agony while on the cross. And so if you're going to read through some of the language around resurrection, and specifically you're going to have the opportunity to read Lee Strobel. Lee Strobel, in his study of resurrection, he makes the case that a word excruciating comes into existence because of the agony and the pain people experienced while they are on the cross. I think that's a fascinating sort of a situation. And it's also very interesting that there are other words that are biblical words that only appear because of the Christian context. For instance, the word agape, for love, doesn't appear anywhere else except inside of biblical Greek to describe what love looks like in the midst of community. So the word excruciating comes into existence, according to Lee Strobel, around the idea of crucifixion, and other scholars as well have mentioned that too. And so last week then, we left Jesus right here. Let's go to the next slide. And he is on the cross. That's where we left him. And that's where our conversation ended. We closed last week right here. So we want to pick that up, and we want to go ahead and tell you that 63 cards were completed last week. 63 cards were completed. You guys should be teaching this class. 54 of you are very certain about the resurrection. Now let me tell you, four of you, quite certain to all, very certain. Five, some uncertainty in the midst of that. But let me show you the reason why for you this was important and why you answered that, which I think is a bit more telling as well. Let's go to the next slide if we could. 45 of you said that you're certain because you have an internal witness or an assurance that God's done something inside of your life. You know the resurrection's true because something's happened inside of your life. 10 of you mentioned that you're certain because you've evaluated some of the historical evidence, and you found it compelling enough that when you do that, you're recognizing that something's happening there. And then 4 of you were thinking, yeah, I think that if God raised Jesus from the dead, God's done something in my life, God must be real in the midst of that. Some of you kind of combined the arguments. And so notice the 45 and 4, that second 4 goes with the 4 down there at historical. So some of you said, listen, I think that Jesus showed up and there were eyewitnesses, plus he's done something in my life. And then some of you said, listen, there's an internal witness. God's done something in my life. And if he's done something in my life, I think that God must be real. So that's what that looks like, that snapshot out of Sharptown. Several of you sent me texts this week and said, hey, what was the results? I wanted to go ahead and give those back to you. And like I said, you should be teaching this class, because I struggle sometimes over the years, that not so much with the uncertainty, but how do I have conversations with people who don't believe the Bible? And so I can't talk to them in this language. Well, the Bible says, and they said, I don't care what the Bible says. I don't believe the Bible. And so that's where I want to go ahead and try to give you a few tools for your toolbox, because we can, in fact, have intelligent conversations with people in a skeptical world that we live in, that Jesus Christ has been raised from the dead. We can do that. And it doesn't sound silly. You don't have to lean into a warm feeling you've had inside your heart. There's historical evidence that we can verify, and that there is a veracity to it. And so let me go ahead and begin this week with this statement. Okay, we talked about it doesn't make a difference where you are as far as scholarship is concerned. there are some minimal facts about the resurrection, and Habermas uses this argument, and these are facts that are backed by so much evidence that nearly every scholar who studies the subject, even the skeptical ones, accept these facts. By the end of our time together, over 6 weeks, you will have the whole list of these facts. There are 12 of them. He lists 12, but when he's debating people who were skeptics, he only uses 6. So I'm going to give you the whole list eventually, but we're going to talk a little bit about that. The first is, and very important, like we said last week, is this. Jesus died by crucifixion. Jesus died by crucifixion. This statement, this is the most evidenced and best historical fact from the life of Jesus. No one debates this. Well, let me back up. That's not true. With the insurgence of the internet, and finding ourselves in the information age, there is a group of people who write on the internet, not respected scholars, not people who have an academic pedigree. They're people who write on the internet, and these individuals now have their own category. They are called mythicists. Say that one 3 times fast, okay? Mythicists. I've been practicing all week. Mythicists. And they ask questions, leading questions that sound like this. Well, tell me why you believe the Jesus myth is true. Tell me why you believe the Jesus myth about the resurrection is true. And their presumption is, number one, that Jesus is not a historical person, and that Jesus is not a person who actually lived in history, and that Jesus was actually not a flesh and blood individual, but that he was a myth, or that the recorded things in the Bible or extra biblical outside the Bible, they too are myths. And so this group of people, which is very current, you can go on most any social media page. Not that I'm a professional at social media, but I poked around enough to recognize, you know, tell me about the mythicists. Let me read a little bit about that. And listen, this is all over. It's replete on inside of our culture. And so the understanding that Jesus really might not have even existed, or that the resurrection is a myth, is something that is very much alive inside of our culture today. And quite honestly, very much alive in the high school students, college students, inside of the language, the things that they're reading online, and the places where they read. But I want to tell you, let's anchor in here, that the most evidenced and the best known historical fact from the life of Jesus is his death. And so let's let the skeptics, let's let the atheists, let's let the agnostics talk to us about that. So let's go to the next slide if we could. Here's that dude, Bart Ehrman. He's the, listen, leading voice from the other side. He said that the most certain element of the tradition about Jesus is that he was crucified on orders from Pontius Pilate. And then he goes on to say, listen, don't take my word for it. 20 independent sources, 15 corroborate the crucifixion. 10 of them are from the New Testament. Again, how close to the event it takes place, okay? From 30 AD to 130 AD. In the first 100 years, we have 20 independent sources. 15 of them corroborate the crucifixion. Jesus died. He died. Then Crossan, again, tied to the Jesus seminar, that he was crucified is as sure as anything historical can ever be. These are not people whose worldview includes God. These are people whose worldview does not include God. You can have this conversation with people who do not believe the Bible, leaning into the historicity of the resurrection of Jesus. And so let me go ahead and let's take a minute. We're going to look at a Bible verse, and we're going to go ahead and pull out the eyewitnesses that Jesus was crucified and that he died. Okay? So the first book in the New Testament that was written, Kristen mentioned the idea about the chronology, about how the New Testament is put together. You'd think, well, gosh, the first book of the New Testament is Matthew. It is not. It is not. It is not Mark. Mark's close. It is not Luke. It is not John. Most people would go ahead and say that the first book inside the New Testament is the book of Thessalonians, 1 Thessalonians. And Paul is the one who's the author. And so let's go ahead and go, again, the earliest source we can find, 1 Thessalonians, for we believe that Jesus died and rose again. If this is the earliest, closest historical record, that's what Paul has to say. And so think with me about the idea of the crucifixion of Jesus. Let's look at who was there on site. Let's go to the next slide if we could. You're doing a fabulous job, Marge. Thank you so much. The female disciples at the cross, all four Gospels. John the disciple. We know John was there because Jesus calls down off the cross and says, John, there's your mother, mom. You got to take care of John now. John, take care of my mom. John was there. Peter was there in the vicinity. That's as close as we can get. Luke mentions he's in the vicinity. Peter is not courageous enough to show up at the site, but he's close enough. Joseph of Arimathea, listed in all four Gospels. Joseph of Arimathea is a high-level Jewish leader in the Sanhedrin. He is responsible for providing the tomb that Jesus was buried at. We know that Joseph of Arimathea was there because he knew then when to ask Pontius Pilate about burying Jesus. Joseph of Arimathea was there. Pontius Pilate knew that Jesus was dead. He might not have been like on site watching. He was close enough to provide validation that Jesus was dead. As a matter of fact, the New Testament says that Pontius Pilate was concerned about how quickly Jesus dies. How quickly he dies. And then the centurion's listed inside of Mark's gospel. Now, right around the early 1800s, there is a movement, again, against the factual evidence inside of what the New Testament has to say. Remember, let's go to the next slide, just real quickly to remind you. Here it is. Christ died, he was buried, was raised on the third day, then he appeared, okay? Keep that in your mind, okay? And so the first opponent with regards to this whole resurrection story begins to happen and gathers momentum around two particular people and around two particular people around this particular topic. Jesus died. Jesus died. If we can somehow undercut that statement, if we can somehow go ahead and disprove that, then the whole resurrection story falls apart. And so we even live in a culture who, well, let's take a look at this and see. Let's go to the next slide if we could. This is called the swoon theory. How many of you ever heard about this? Raise your hand nice and high. Okay, root swoon theory. Okay, this swoon theory says this. Oh, by the way, these things, these areas where people are opponents of the resurrection come in categories, okay? This is called a misconception theory, and we'll talk about four of those over the next couple of weeks, okay? This is the first. Misconception theory. Starts right around the early 1800s. Jesus didn't die, he just passed out. He passed out because of the pain. He passed out because he didn't have enough fluid in his body. He passed out because of the shock that he may have experienced. Jesus passed out. Or that you read in Mark's gospel, they gave him something to drink, and listen, somehow, some way, they laced it with some sort of anesthesia. And so as a result of that, Jesus really didn't die. He just succumbed to the anesthesia that was on the sponge, and as a result of that, he fainted. And so that was one thought for a while, that Jesus somehow fell into a coma, and he no longer was kind of demonstrating, you know, the idea that he was alive, but he was in a deep coma. And the people who executed Jesus, that he was mistaken. He was mistaken. They thought he was dead. He just really wasn't dead. He really wasn't dead. And then Jesus woke up when he wound up in the tomb, and he managed to escape. He managed to escape. Now you're thinking, gosh, people really don't believe this. Or maybe you're thinking, I have friends that believe this. And let me just tell you, this is part of our culture. This is part of our culture. Let me demonstrate this to you if I could. Next slide. Here in the last several years are a number of novels that you may recognize the title to, or may recognize the authors of these novels, that have been proponents of this idea. And so as a result of that, you recognize, listen, you can go back. You know the name D.H. Lawrence. Many of you have been in English class, okay? He wove that into a short story. The Passover Plot, which is still, there was a movie that hit Hollywood based on that book. In 72, another author, 82, 92, kind of get this pattern, right? Every 10 years, right, this comes out or so. The idea that Jesus really did not die. He didn't die. And so something's happened to him. Yeah, Gary. Yeah, don't run ahead of us yet. You're on it. We're going to open that up, okay? We're going to open that up. Now, listen. No. Just hold the comment for a minute or two, okay? You're crossing the finish line before we get our last lap, okay? No. Okay, look. So, look, now listen to this. And the Quran, this is fascinating. You probably don't know this. I didn't know this. Okay, you might have known this. The Quran says that when Jesus is carrying the cross to Calvary, that Jesus and Simon of Cyrene switch places, and Jesus leaves the country and goes to India, and Simon of Cyrene dies on the cross. That's what the Quran says. And so listen. You think about how many people who are Islam inside of our world, and that's their perspective about Jesus. And you're going to go ahead and say, hey, listen, all you have to do is open up the Bible. And they're going to go ahead and say, that doesn't make any sense, because that's not how Jesus died. And again, don't take my word. You can click around and find this. Right? You can click around and find this. But that's a fascinating thing when you do some comparative religions study, right? Simon and Jesus, they switched places. Jesus left the country, and then Simon died. Now, I'm going to jump ahead with Gary here for a moment. I don't know how the Quran explains the fact that Jesus looks down off of the cross and says, Mary, that's your son, and that the people, John and Mary, don't know that that's Jesus on the cross. I don't know how to, right? That doesn't make any sense to me. But listen, it's in the Quran. That's where it is. All right, now, Gary, hold on. Hold on, Oz, just a second. Hold on. Okay, and then we're going to open this up, swing this open. Okay, let's go to the next slide if we could. Here is the slide again. Jesus passed out. Jesus was given some type of anesthesia. Jesus was somehow comatose. Executioners, this was their job, by the way. The executioners somehow mistook that Jesus really wasn't dead and he really was alive. And then Jesus woke up in the tomb and he managed to escape. And then he found his followers. Now is the time, okay? Look at the swoon theory. And what do you want to say about the swoon theory, okay? Gary, what do you want to say about the swoon theory? Go ahead. Yeah.
Scientists now have stated that only happens when a person dies.
Nice job.
That only happens
Nice job by you. So validation of death medically could be that when the spear pierced the side of Jesus, when the blood pierces through the pleural cavity, when the blood pierces through, what's the lining of the heart called, and blood and water flow out, correct, that is a validation of death. Okay, anybody else want to talk about the swoon theory? Yeah, Oz. Yeah, there certainly are other validations that are extra biblical, and I'm going to go ahead and show you a slide of five of them in just a second. Somebody else want to say something about the swoon theory? Yes. So Janet's statement was that even if he did pass out, if he passed out, that means, look, he would have done this. And when he does this, everything and all the weight is upon this part of the body, and he can't breathe because he would not be able, asphyxiation would kill him. And so Janet's statement is, okay, let's go ahead and give into the swoon theory, and that maybe he did receive some anesthesia, or maybe somehow he was comatose. That would not happen because he would die because he couldn't breathe anyhow. That's a good observation. Yep, yes, please. Jen? Say it again. How would he be able to move the stone from the tomb? Great thought, Jen. Great thought, okay? A really, really good thought, okay? We're going to talk about that in just a second. Yeah.
He couldn't survive 3 days in a tomb without any medical help or anything.
Yeah. Janet's statement was, given the physical condition, I'm going to use the word deterioration of Jesus' physical body, that he's not going to be able to sustain life while he's entombed in order to go ahead and get out of the tomb. Go ahead, Vic.
So the Quran
statement. Yeah, that's a good one, isn't it? Yeah, yeah. The Quran statement, Vicky says, okay, when you look at this logically, how do the soldiers mistake the beaten guy from the non-beaten guy? That's kind of an interesting observation. Go ahead, Mike. You're about ready to jump out of your chair. Go ahead. I'm open for different thoughts. Yeah. No, it is not. The idea for a skeptic is, if you can take the first pillar, let's think of those four statements as the cornerstones, okay, or the right, the four corners. And so if you can knock one of those out, then the argument is diminished, right? Okay, the argument is diminished. Very important then to go ahead and take a shot at Jesus really didn't die. Who else? Yes, go ahead, Rob. Yeah. 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 You're right on this. Okay, so the idea, Robin's statement was, hey, hold on a second. My words, not yours, but this is her observation. If Pontius Pilate is part of the Apostles' Creed, and we know that Christianity is woven together with history, We know when Caiaphas was the person who was in charge. We know when Pontius Pilate was leading. We know these are historical facts. Then, clearly, aren't there other statements around Jesus' death that we can look at? And also, isn't it true that if this is historical too, they make these statements that Jesus did die, it must be kind of a historical reality? Let's go ahead and let me go to the next slide if we could. Well, no, back up if we could. Hold on a second. Hold on a second, Marge. Just a minute. Oh. Don't tell me. All right, so I want to go ahead and to share with you, Marge, after that ermine crossing slide, It starts with Josephus, Tacitus, Lucian. Yeah, that's it. These are five historical people in history who mention the death of Jesus, that are extra biblical material outside the Bible. So five places that you can point to the veracity of the death of Jesus, and I have condensed their statements and put them in quotes for you. So Josephus, he was a Jewish historian in the early church, and he made the statement that Pilate, to Robin's point, Pilate had him crucified. And then again, this gentleman is named Tacitus, okay? Again, he's kind of a historian who writes. He makes the statement. He calls Jesus Christus, which is perfectly fine. That's who he's referencing. Suffered extreme penalty at the hands of Pontius Pilate. Lucian makes a comment about Christians. It's, again, this is kind of, feels like it's a marginal comment, and it's not directly pointed, but it's enough historical veracity to go ahead and add to our case that Jesus died, that Christians worshiped a man who was crucified. And then, somebody can go ahead and try to pronounce this one. This is, you know, I can go ahead and give that a confident butchering job, and you'd think, oh, maybe that's how you do pronounce that, but you'd just be wrong. And anyhow, that's one of the dirty secrets. If you don't know how to pronounce something, just say it with confidence, right? People think you're right, okay? So the Jews, by the murder of their wise king, and then the Talmud, which is a representation of Scripture inside of Scripture, Yeshua was hanged upon a tree, and that's the inference at that point. These are five extra-biblical accounts about Jesus died. So I want to go ahead and kind of emphasize that. Marge, thanks so much for finding that. And before we go ahead and go off that slide, and before we stop talking about the swoon theory, anybody else have a comment that they want to go ahead? Because listen, we need to go ahead and nail this specific topic down before we go on any further. Yes, Gary. Yeah.
The Shroud of Turin. There is more evidence now that is actually, scientists have actually found out that image that's on that shroud, yeah, they cannot produce it. There's no way that they can produce it. And if they have actually found that the image on that Shroud of Turin is in motion, it's actually an in motion.
Mm-hmm.
All the energy that it would have taken, the world couldn't produce that amount of energy.
Mm-hmm.
You
are welcome to read a little bit more about that if you want to, the Shroud of Turin. We're going to pick that up several weeks from now as well. But I think that great observation with regards to that, and have a chance to see, does that factually play into this whole resurrection sort of a case that we're making historically. Sure. Anybody else around the swoon theory? We good? No? Yes, go ahead, Phyllis.
Are you saying
these references are extra biblical, okay? So they are not in the Bible. These are people who have written in history. And all of them happen within the first 100 years of the death of Jesus, okay? The first 100 years of the death of Jesus. The first two happen within the first 30 years of the death of Jesus. And then listen, if you wanted to push it out another 50 years, all the way to AD 180, then listen, it just becomes way more than we can even fit on a couple of slides. Okay? Yeah. All right. Anything else? Oh, I want to go ahead and say to you, this, I'm getting this from the sound booth. So this is gospel. The slides for today's Sunday school are now available through the QR code in the bulletin. That's a beautiful thing. So some of you are taking pictures. You don't have to take any more pictures, right? You can look, find the QR code. I don't know how to do that, but find the QR code, okay? And you can find these slides, okay? All right. So, swoon theory. Take a breath, okay? Now we're going to shift gears just a little, all right? And so let me just, let's go ahead and a couple slides forward to, in my family, some of you were here at my dad's funeral service. One of the things that happened in my life was that as I was growing up, my dad always told me, oh yeah, I had dinner with Babe Ruth. And I never, you know, did he really have dinner with Babe Ruth? I don't know. And so then they produced this family picture, and my dad having dinner with Babe Ruth. He played baseball at a really, really high level in American Legion ball. He won some sort of national tournament and had dinner with Babe Ruth. And there's a bunch of other Hall of Famers on that table as well. And so when it came time for show and tell in school, I always used to want to take the picture of Babe Ruth, and my mom would never be able to find the picture when I needed it. Look, Mom, show and tell on, you know, on Friday, you need to pick it. Could never find it. And so I found it actually in the newspaper of my dad's, where he grew up in Ohio. And so those red, that's Babe Ruth on the end. And the only reason I'm going ahead and tell you this is because it ties in to our next point. And here's the next point. Go to the next slide. Next slide. Next slide. There we go. In 1932, in the World Series, with a 2-2 count, Yankees were playing the Cubs. And the Cubs were all over Babe Ruth when he came up to hit. As a matter of fact, they're catcalling him. The Cubs themselves, the people at Wrigley Field, it's getting really obnoxious. And Babe Ruth, two strikes, two balls, stands back in the batter's box, and look. He points, and this goes down in baseball history, okay? It goes down in baseball history because they use this terminology. Babe Ruth called his shot. Next pitch, Babe Ruth sends the ball the exact same place where he was pointing, dead center field. And so one of the authors that we're working from, let's go to the next slide, says this. The reason why I believe in the resurrection is because Jesus called his shot. He called it. He called it. He had the audacity to call it. And that the hashtag, if they lived in a hashtag world back then, the hashtag for the New Testament would be hashtag on the third day. On the third day. And that term, on the third day, is woven through the New Testament gospel story about the resurrection because Jesus calls the shot. Calls the shot. And so one of the reasons why you could have a conversation with somebody about Jesus and about who he is as a person, and even inside a culture, and I'm going to use the Bible, but you can go ahead and even have conversation around that, maybe not using the Bible, is even saying, hey, listen, Jesus told them that he was going to be crucified and rise again, and he did it. And he did it. Let's illustrate this if we can. Next slide. Out of the book of Mark, he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and teachers of the law, and then he must be killed. He must be killed, and after 3 days, rise again. So this is right in the middle of Mark, okay? And we're going to take all these references from Mark. There are others found in Matthew's gospel and in Luke's gospel and in John's gospel. There are so many. I'm just going to represent that to you this morning, okay? Instead of give you the whole list. If you want the whole list, I could certainly provide that for you. Let's go to the next slide. Because he was teaching his disciples, he said to them, the Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men. They will kill him, and after 3 days he will rise. He did not understand that what they meant, and they were afraid to ask him about it. Now, that's kind of how that goes in Mark's gospel. Jesus is trying to tell him, they're going to kill me, and I'm going to rise again, third day. And they didn't understand what he was saying. Now, there is a prophetic statement in the book of Hosea that some authors, some scholars would say that when the Jews heard Jesus talking about the third day, what created such conflict for them internally was the question, is Jesus referencing that particular passage about the third day in Hosea? And if he is, that has everything to do with resurrection. And so that's the reason why we have these kind of statements in the Gospels. They were uncertain. They didn't know how to respond to him. They were uncertain because they didn't know, is he really saying that he's going to do what Hosea's prophetic word said? Okay, so one more illustration of that, if we could. The Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and the teachers of the law, and they will condemn him to death. They'll mock him. They'll spit on him. They'll flog him. They'll kill him. And then, 3 days later, he will rise. Jesus calls his shot. And so Jeremiah Johnston, PhD, he makes the statement that one of the reasons he believes in the resurrection and one of the reasons you can give for believing in the resurrection is that Jesus calls his shot. He calls his shot. And in calling his shot, it centers around the phrase, on the third day. The third day. Or on the third day. And you can trace that through the gospel narrative. Now, let's talk a little bit about this for just a minute. And this will be it might be our last point, but we're going to try to go ahead and summarize a couple things really quickly. So, in the Bible, the idea of the resurrection of Jesus, him calling his own shot, something begins to happen in culture. What happens in culture is that the early church begins to gather on the first day of the week. They begin to gather on the first day of the week. And what's interesting is, let's go to the next slide if you could. Worship begins to shift from Saturday to Sunday. From Saturday to Sunday. Of the appearances of Jesus inside of the New Testament, I think 6 of them happen on Sunday. Pentecost happens on Sunday. There's a dynamic that begins to shift inside of history around when people begin to gather and when they begin to worship. Now, this is not stated anywhere inside the Bible. You can't chapter and verse and say, okay, listen, people stopped worshiping on Sunday, stopped worshiping on Saturday, they started worshiping on Sunday as believers. Scripture never mentions Sabbath, Saturday gatherings by believers. It stops being mentioned. Believers start gathering on Sunday, the Lord's Day. The Lord's Day is what it's called inside of Scripture. And you don't read anywhere in the New Testament that they continued to worship on Saturday. And then historically, Sunday, not Saturday, becomes the normal meeting day for Christians. This dates back into the first century. So let me read for you just a couple bullet points from an article out of Christianity Today about the Christian church switches from Saturday to Sunday. No specific times or dates are associated with the church's shift, except that the resurrection occurs on Sunday. Because the resurrection and the beginning of creation both occur on the first day of the week, the church started to observe Sunday as the day of worship. More Gentiles were becoming Christians as well, and that contributed to the desire to set aside Sabbath on Saturday and begin a new movement that included Gentiles on Sunday. By the end of the first century, Sunday worship was the norm. Jesus calls his shot, resurrection occurs, and worship shifts gears from Saturday to Sunday. It's not implicit. It's not you have to start worshiping on the Lord's Day. It is a way to venerate, acknowledge, and celebrate the resurrected Christ. I'm going to say to you, every time you walk through the doors, we celebrate the resurrection on Sunday. We're not consciously aware of it, but when we walk through the doors, we gather on Sunday because of the resurrection of Jesus. Thoughts, comments, questions? Anybody? I gave you a homework assignment last week. Yep. Oh, I'm sorry, Jay. Yeah, so Jay's comment was, is that symbolic, or does that remind us too about the whole idea of Scripture that says about a renewed mind or having a renewed mind or rethinking about something differently? And I would go ahead and say I wouldn't have any problem with that statement at all. That certainly would make sense to me. I mean, it's kind of a reframing of what worship looks like, or the time of worship or faith, because it moves from hundreds of years being centered here on Saturday to a brand new dynamic that we've never seen before, right? That's a great observation. Anybody else? I gave you an assignment last week to read through the Gospels, we will finish this, okay? Look, we'll pick this up next week. Don't panic, okay? Some of you went ahead and did your assignment, and you're going to think, you didn't even call on me, okay? So, okay, I get that. So the assignment was to read through the Gospels and notice, if you would, the similarities, notice the differences. Now, let me say this to you. This is not a minor issue. This is a major issue. The major issue is this, that if the Gospels can't tell the exact same story, then maybe the exact same story isn't true. Are you with me? Okay, now, think with me, though. I'm not going to have them stand back up again, but think where we started today, Frank and Carl and Cody, all right? If they all just told Cody's story with the exact same words, with the exact same images, would that strengthen the story, or would that somehow diminish the story? If all of the Gospels had the exact same wording, if all the Gospels had the exact same account, so let me just kind of leave that there and let you ponder that one a little bit. We're not going anywhere for the next couple weeks, okay? You can sit with that for just a minute. Okay, so let's go ahead, and if you did not read through the Gospels, I'm going to volunteer this information to you. Let's go to the next slide if we could, and listen, Marge Roberts is a champ. I didn't give this to her till 20 after 7 this morning, okay? At the time of day, Matthew says at dawn on the first day of the week. Mark says very early on the first day of the week, just after sunrise. Luke says very early on the first day of the week. John says early on the first day of the week, still dark. Now, one thing we can say, the commonality is, it's the what day of the week? It's the... Nice job by you. Outstanding historians. So let me ask you, if you're a person who's investigating the claims of Christ, how do you put these statements together? Or does this shake your faith just a little bit because they don't use the exact same words? I know it's 10:30, but listen, we have to go ahead and just have a couple comments about this. This is where we'll start next Sunday. Ozzy, go ahead. All right. Okay. So when you make the statement, they got to get together and figure that out. Some of you are already looking at those things and thinking, okay, how do we figure this out? Okay, so Diana.
I'm an English teacher, so if I collect an essay and four kids all work the exact same
Come on, Diana. Huh? Look, how do I know that's true? Because Diana said so. She's an English teacher.
Janet?
So the fact that each of those gospel writers address different audiences. So
okay. Okay. Yes, Amy.
So, in electronic medical records. If you want everybody to like say how the lungs sound using the same like language, you actually can have to present selections that they click, right? Because you know that if you offer narrative code, there's always going to be some variation about how the same assessment on the same person.
Okay. All right. So let's start then there, okay, and ask this question: is it possible that the gospel writers, some of them are starting to tell the story at the time that the women left the house, and some of them are telling the story at the time the women arrived at the tomb? Just asking the question, if some are telling the story about when Jesus or when they left the house, that could be while it's still dark, right? Because I believe it's probably about a 2-mile walk, if I'm not mistaken. Now we don't have that information here, but trust me when I tell you that, about a 2-mile walk. Yes. Okay. The base statement is the same. The wording may be different. If you're talking to a skeptic, they're going to go ahead and say, that's validation for the reason I don't want to believe. It's not the exact same. But listen, we're going to pick this up right here next week. Okay? If you are an overachiever, you want to go on and read about this online. Okay? Again, depending upon where you read, you're going to go ahead and read about, okay, the statements around the resurrection on Easter Sunday morning. Some of them are going to go ahead and say, well, this is the reason you shouldn't believe. Some of them are going to go ahead and provide some rationale about why you're going to have a difference of opinion. Nice job by you. Good job reading. Good job staying engaged. Nice job staying with us. We'll pick this up next week. We'll next week, again, address one of the statements about, in history, a misconception theory. And then we'll also pick up another reason or two why you should believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Again, trying to give you a little bit more historical perspective in non-biblical literature that you can go ahead and consider. Pray with me, if you will. Lord, go with us this week and help us to be your disciples. Would you help us to look for opportunities to engage other people in the conversation about the reality of Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection, and how that prompts us to call him Lord and Savior of our lives. In your name we pray. Amen. See you later.